Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming out. And you truly are the hardcore. So my name is Larry Drake, and I want to welcome you to Portsmouth. Marsha Moody, who organizes. Let's give Marsha a hand. Marsha asked me to make the introduction, and it's really an honor for me to introduce John Nichols. From the last half hour, I think John knows all of you personally. So this shouldn't be too hard, but for those of you who don't know John, he is the Washington, D.C. correspondent for The Nation magazine. He is also a prolific author, and today he'll be talking about his book, The S Word, about socialism in the United States. He was here a couple of years ago at the Portsmouth Library to talk about his book, Dollarocracy, which is amazingly timely. So he's here today, and of course many of you have probably seen him on MSNBC or heard him on the radio. I always look forward to John's reports about the struggles in Wisconsin, the whole battle about union rights there. So he's written quite a few books, a lot of them about the whole issue of media reform. And John, I heard you speak, I believe it was 2007 in Memphis. There was a the media reform conference. So John is, I think, one of the best commentators from a progressive perspective of the current political scene in the United States. And it really is, we're really lucky that he's here. And I'm not going to go on anymore, and I'm going to just turn it over to John. Let's give John a hand.
For coming, and I want to tell you that I am a fan of the New England Patriots. I just wish they weren't playing today. But I'm delighted for our circle of folks who've come out. And we're going to do this a little bit differently than a lot of things that we do. I'm going to talk to you in a moment, but before I do, I want to emphasize to you that what I'm interested in is an expansion of our discourse, bringing more issues in, talking about more than we do in America. Because I think the crisis in American politics is not the left or the right. I think the crisis in American politics is the middle. My sense is that we have a corrupt middle. And we have all sorts of people who say, well, I'm looking for compromise. I'm looking for the place where we can all work together. But the problem is, they don't come into that saying, I believe in something. And so they're ready to compromise from day one. And the weird thing about it is the people who show up right away are folks with a whole bunch of money. And they say, you're ready to compromise? We're ready to support you. And if you drive across this state, you are going to see, even as my daughter and I drove out here this afternoon, we saw these billboards that said, fix the debt. You know, and it's like, oh my gosh, it's some of the nicest billboards I've ever seen. Big, giant, fix the debt. And I mean, who could be against fixing the debt? Nobody wants to be in debt. No, it's a terrible idea. Problem is, fix the debt is paid for by billionaires. Some of the richest men in America started this fix the debt campaign. And their concept is that they want to fix America's debts by lowering taxes on the rich. I know, it's amazing that billionaires would come up with that idea. Lowering taxes on the rich while shifting more of the burden onto working people. And one of their genius ideas for fixing the debt, one of the ones that's been floated along the way, and this one you can't beat it because you're sure it's going to work, is let people retire later and maybe give them a little less Medicare and a little less Social Security. And so you realize, this is what you get when you start from a place of compromise. I love it when I've got somebody on the left who says, I don't believe in that. Here's what I absolutely want. I don't want to make people who have worked in a nursing home for 35 years, now are themselves in their 60s, helping somebody who's in their 90s out of bed retire 3 years later. because their Social Security won't kick in until they're 68 or 70 or 72. I don't want to fix the debt that way. So I like that person on the left that says that. And I don't mind the person, the libertarian on the right, who comes in and says, I don't even think we should have Social Security. Right? Then we can have a real debate. We'll wrestle that out because we have honest players on each side stating their view. The crisis of American politics is that right now we say the range of opinion is from General Electric to General Motors. It's between these two corporations. And that doesn't work. So we're going to talk about that a little. But I want to introduce two friends of mine before I say anything more. Because in New Hampshire, you have people who are actually doing the job of expanding the discourse and asking the tough questions and doing the right thing. And so as I've done this trip around the country and talk about this book, and always when I do things like this, I like to bring other people into the discourse rather than to just say, oh, my piece. And so the first person I want to bring up is a person who should have been the governor of New Hampshire. And I, more than 20 years ago, this is how unbelievably old I am. More than 20 years ago, in the spring of my youth, I was at Keene State University. And I was traveling around New Hampshire in 1992 in a car with Alexander Kopkind, the great writer for The Nation magazine, and with Mika Sifri, who's now been one of the great tech gurus of how we're going to have the internet do save all of us and do all these things. People went on to do incredible things, and they're sitting in the safest seat in the car with us was Ralph Nader. And Ralph Nader was asking people to write his name in for president in order to shake up the political process in 1992. And we got out to Keene State University, I hope I've got the name right, and there was a huge crowd. Like, the place was absolutely packed because people had been looking for a long time for some alternative. They decided it wasn't Nader that year. But, in fact, they decided it wasn't Nader that year, they decided it wasn't Nader 4 years later, they decided it wasn't Nader 4 years after that, they decided it wasn't Nader 4 years later. They decided it quite often for Ralph. But what Ralph was saying then was really important. And what was fascinating was that I'm standing there talking to all these people, and I met like the coolest person in the room. It was amazing. There was this totally cool person who was, you know, a state legislator and completely outspoken. She was like Bernie Sanders, somebody who seemed like she should be in Brooklyn, but was in fact up in New England. And then the most amazing part of all was she was running for governor and she was going to be the Democratic nominee for governor of the state. And I was like, this is, man, the whole world is changing. And unfortunately, as is so often the case, I was 20-some years ahead of the curve in recognizing her genius. And so New Hampshire did not make her the governor. And New Hampshire didn't even make her a member of Congress, as I wish they had. But Arnie Arneson has created one of the best radio shows in America. I celebrate it at a national level, and also other people are as well. Arnie's show has been picked up in Iowa. She does work in Iowa, and now in other states around the country. And I know you don't say it from out there. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my friend, Arnie Arneson, to talk for a moment about some of the stuff she's doing. Arnie Arneson. She didn't totally know. I love you more. All right.
Is that, it's the day, some of you may know the story, but it's the day before the election of 1992. It's the year of Clinton and Perot and Bush, and I'm running for governor as the first woman nominee in state history. And my brother is one of those Wall Street bankers, and he calls me up because I happen to be changing my shoes at a little shoe store in Nashua, New Hampshire. I changed boots three times because it was so wet and rainy the day before the election. And he finds me and tracks me down and he says to me, go out and buy the Wall Street Journal. And I said to my brother, why? And he said, buy it and turn to the editorial page. And I said, I wrap my fish in the editorial page. He said, just send someone out and buy it. So one of my aides went running out to buy the paper. And this is actually a connection to John Nichols on The Nation. And he comes running into the shoe store screaming, going, "You're not going to believe this. You're not going to believe this." And so we rip open the Wall Street Journal and we turn to the editorial page, and there is this little last paragraph called the aside. Right? And here's what the aside said in the Wall Street Journal the day before the election. It said, "The Nation magazine has picked 12 liberals they want to see win in America tomorrow. Barbara Boxer, Carol Moseley Braun, Russ Feingold," and they went through the list. And then they said, "We have looked all over America, and there's only one liberal we want to see win tomorrow. That in-your-face feminist taxer, Arnie Arneson." That was the Wall Street Journal the day before the election of 1992. So one, I guess I have to thank the Nation because they were part of that paragraph. But in an interesting way, it's really important to run. It's really important, as John said, to talk about your ideas and put them out there and not be afraid. Don't self-censor. And the reason is that when you run and speak the truth, you change the conversation because you ran well. And you ran with an open voice. And when you run well and even lose, it changes. It changes the conversation. And his comment about the idea that this middle that is so pathetic, because it's not, and he's really right, when you think about one side and the other, here's where the middle is. You actually find middle. But when the conversation happens here, this is where middle is. And that's not where America is. And that's not where our values are. And the beauty of having this conversation is that you get to the radical middle. It's a radical middle. That's what it is. And the reason I am excited about the reaction to Bernie and his comments about single payer as someone who has always been so frightened by what's happened to healthcare in America, because I ran on single payer too when I ran for governor in 1992. And what is so important is that if you look at what happened with Obamacare and Hillary Care, it's because single payer wasn't even allowed on the table. We never had the conversation. So when you don't even put it on the table, this is where the compromise is. With the Heritage Foundation, the Gingrich plan, that's what you got because it wasn't on the table. And I just want everyone to know that NPR was talking about this yesterday, and they interviewed Max Baucus. And the reason why I did that, everyone, is that Max Baucus had the chutzpah on NPR to actually say he had regrets that maybe they should have at least put single payer on the table because maybe they could have gotten something better. What you may not know about Max Baucus is that he was the chair of the Senate Finance Committee, and when a group of doctors and nurses asked him to at least consider it, he had them arrested not once, but twice. Arrested for what? For asking that you consider single payer, just put it on the table. And not only did he have them arrested, but he voted against the public option twice. And he was on NPR just the other day talking about his regrets. My regret was him. And last but not least, what was the payback for what Max Baucus did to provide for the insurance companies and provide for the pharmaceutical companies and make sure single payer was not even allowed on the table? He's now the ambassador to China. That was the payback. So I just want everyone to know, and why I'm angry at NPR, is they never qualified who he was and what he did. And then last but not least, he does like single payer. Max Baucus is a liar. And let me tell you why I know. Because in his state of Montana, they were poisoned by W.R. Grace. And they were poisoned in this county in Montana. No insurance company would cover anyone in that county. He has an exception in the law where everyone in that county gets Medicare. Single payer Medicare if you live in that county in Montana. So what he didn't want for us, what doctors he arrested, what lie he did on NPR the other day, he made sure that it worked for his people. Because he understood that the only way, and what I want is,
I want the county in Montana. I want that same county around Love Canal. I want that same county in Flint, Michigan. Flint, that's it, John. Oh, my God.
Yes.
Flint, that's it. I love it. I'm so glad I said this. Thank you. No, no, no. Write about it. I just posted on Facebook that our obligation to Flint, Michigan is health care, reparations for what happened, for the loss of businesses. You need to write that what Max Baucus did for that county in Montana now needs to happen in Flint. And P.S., how many other places have been poisoned? Get on the Max bagwagon. And make sure you get Medicare for all there. So just to let you know, but that's important. That is important.
It, yes.
Please, John, write about that.
This is Arnie, stay here for a second. Arnie, stay up for a second. Arnie Arneson, ladies and gentlemen, Arnie Arneson, who does this to me every day. She likes emails me and calls me and says, oh, you gotta write this. You gotta do this. But
don't you think it's brilliant?
She is brilliant, and brothers and sisters, you need to know that she is on the radio in New Hampshire, but not always in every part of New Hampshire. Tell them where you are at and how people can follow you, and also what you might think would be a good idea for Portsmouth.
Well, so we're on a little radio station, WNHNFM.org. We stream live, we podcast, we're on every day, we do a show every day. It's up on the Pacifica Network. My biggest audience is in Houston, Texas, with 100,000 listeners. So I'm heard everywhere but here. So I'm just telling you to do that. And I am going to be grateful you brought me up. I hadn't thought about Flint and Montana, but
that was really good. Ladies and gentlemen, Arnie Arneson. I will tell you, you know, it's not too late to elect your governor. I want to just bring up one other person for a moment here to talk a little bit about what I think is one of the coolest projects in America. And I believe that the great crisis in America is that as we have flowed money into our politics, and the Supreme Court has done us incredible damage, we just marked the 6th anniversary of their decision in Citizens United, but it's a host of decisions over the years in Buckley v. Vallejo and the McCutcheon decision, and now threatening labor unions. Decision after decision after decision that tips the balance, flows that money in. At the same time, our media has absolutely declined. We don't have, you look at any newspaper in America, it is less than it was 10 years ago. It is dramatically less than it was 20 or 30 years ago. Radio has not filled that void unless you can get Arnie's show. And the internet hasn't either. The internet gives us lots of bits and pieces, but doesn't begin to give us, you know, anything near that center of gravity that we used to have. And so organizations have to step in and ask the questions that journalists don't ask. And they have to force issues into the discourse, because if they don't, the Koch brothers and others will. This is the bottom line. Money in politics is not about electing candidates. Money in politics is about defining the debate and defining it so narrowly that your range of options are what those who flood the money in want. That's the bottom line of what's happening in our politics. It is a crisis. We have people pulling at it on both sides this year, and that's exciting. But frame that debate. And I think there's a fantastic project that's going on nationally in two states, Iowa and New Hampshire, and it's the American Friends Service Committee's Governing Under the Influence Project. And for those of you that don't know about it, I could explain it all, but that's what the mistake that people make when they do introductions. They tell you what the person's going to say. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to introduce one of my heroes, Olivia Zink, from the Governing Under the Influence Project, and she'll tell you a little bit of what they're doing. Please welcome Olivia.
So my name is Olivia Zink, and I'm the Grassroots Engagement Coordinator at the AFSC here in Concord. And we're working across New Hampshire and Iowa to raise issues of who profits from war and incarceration in a system we call governing under the influence. You can't drive under the influence, right? But you can lobby under the influence, you can make campaign contributions under the influence, you can go through the revolving door under the influence. And so we're raising these issues of who profits from war and incarceration to every presidential candidate. One of the resources that we have is a calendar where all the presidential candidates are going to be, so you want to visit one of them. You can go to our website at gui.afsc.org and visit the presidential candidate. We've been doing bird dog trainings throughout the state. We've done over 50. We've trained over 1,000 activists. I see people smiling because they've been through bird dog training maybe twice. I hope you all take one of these cards. We have some more materials on tips on how to talk to presidential candidates. You have 18 days left of this presidential primary process. So please use it and talk to us if you...
Olivia, before you go, and look at, she is such a good organizer, she's going to hand something out to everybody here. But before you go, tell us what the most interesting thing you've learned from bird dogging is.
Well, I think we have raised the issue of the 34,000 immigrants that are detained every day. There's a federal budget mandate that locks up 34,000 immigrants every day. We've raised this issue. A group of Quaker high school students brought a car to Hillary Clinton and then ended up getting it in Clinton's immigration policy when she had rolled out her immigration policy that we were not going to incarcerate 34,000 immigrants. We've raised this issue with other Democratic presidential candidates, and actually in a town hall in Franklin, New Hampshire, I raised my hand and actually got Jeb Bush to say he doesn't believe that we should have a quota on locking up our immigrants. So we have been raising this issue and influencing the agenda. The other issue that we've been talking about is whose profits from the $1 trillion we're about to spend on nuclear weapons. And so there's people in this room that's talked to every presidential candidate about nuclear weapons policies and should we spend $1 trillion. And I think the most interesting comment I got on nuclear weapons was from the Donald Trump, who told me that, oh, the rest of the world spends more on nuclear weapons than we do. So if you get a chance to talk to him tomorrow in Farmington, just right up the road, if you want to head up 16 and talk to him about nuclear weapons tomorrow at 7 o'clock, he's right in your area.
Olivia Zink from the Governing Under the Influence Project. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention that my friend Arnie Alpert is here as well, who's been such a central person. So thank you so much for coming out. And can I just tell you, what an amazing thing with Donald Trump. That we don't even call him Donald Trump anymore, as Olivia said, the Donald Trump. So on that happy note, let's talk a little bit about socialism.
Yes. Yeah.
Let's talk a little about socialism. Now, I did not anticipate when I wrote the book, The S Word, that democratic socialism was going to, as quickly as I thought, become a big deal in America. It was my sense it might take a few more years. But I want to begin my remarks tonight by celebrating the person who I believe has done more than anyone else to take this concept of democratic socialism, which was really pushed to the edges of our politics, pushed to the edges of our discourse, and to make it central to what we as Americans talk about. And so, ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause for Sarah Palin. I'm not kidding. I know some of you may have thought I was going to mention someone else who's been in the news recently. But I give my regard to Sarah Palin, and let me tell you why. About 6-7 years ago, when I was starting to work on this project, I was listening to Sean Hannity on Fox News. Now, as you know, no media outlet talks more about socialism than Fox News. And Sean Hannity was on, and he had Sarah Palin on his show. And they were talking about the horrors of the Obama presidency. And they were terrified by a new plan from President Obama. They were calling it out. They were exposing it. Weatherization. Yes, the Obama administration was urging people to weatherize their windows so the cold didn't get in. And they were actually providing tax credits and other benefits to those who weatherized their houses. And Sean Hannity turned to Sarah Palin and said, "You know what that is?" And Sarah Palin said, "Socialism." And I thought to myself, if keeping the cold out is socialism, I better write a book about this. Because my sense is that people are going to like this idea. A winner. And the incredible thing is, that sounds so absurd, but over the last maybe 8 years, ever since Barack Obama became president of the United States, our friends on the right have been screaming about socialism. They're not really screaming about socialism. They're screaming about a president they don't like, and they're trying to make him the other. They're trying to make him foreign. They're trying to say, Barack Obama, he's not really one of us. He's a socialist. And in fact, they've done it so much for so long that when President Obama was interviewed a while back by Jeff Salini from the New York Times, at the end of the interview, the New York Times reporter asked the president, by the way, I know this is kind of kooky, but are you a socialist? President Obama, taken aback, said, oh, no, I can't, I'm, everything I do is very capitalistic. And that was the end of the interview. Amazingly enough, I read about this in the book. About an hour or so later, at the New York Times office, the phone rings, and they say, it's the White House. This never happens in journalism. They said, the president is on the phone. He just wants to clarify something from the interview. Jeff picks up the phone, says, yes. The president says, you know, I think I was maybe a little bit glib there. I just want to make it absolutely clear. I am scorchingly, totally, 100%, absolutely the most that could ever be not a socialist. I'm the most not socialist person you ever met. And he had like a list, which meant that the government of the United States paused for a few minutes, on some day in 2009, I believe, to make sure that they could come up with a list of all the reasons that they weren't socialist. And this is a big deal. It's a fascinating thing, because they didn't have to work that hard. Let us be clear about how they're not socialist. When they had a chance to reform our healthcare system in a way that would absolutely assure that every single American had quality health care at an affordable cost as a right, not a privilege, that the poorest person in this country, if they got cancer, would get the same quality of care as the richest person in this country, because it's a human being, and a human being has a right to basic health care. When they had a chance to take what every other industrialized country in the world does, and just say, yep, we're going to do a single-payer Medicare for All plan in America, they said, that's the one thing we're not going to do. They took the social democratic response off the table. And then when in 2000, I hope I got this right, about 6-7 years ago, when BP, like, dumped oil all over the Gulf of Mexico, right? An absolute scorching disaster. Easiest thing in the world. What do you do when a big corporation despoils a huge part of the world? You would say, we have the Army Corps of Engineers. We have some of the best experts, scientists in the world. We have all sorts of professionals who are ready to do this. We are going to nationalize that space and say that the United States government is going to absolutely clean it up and make it safe, and then we're going to give a bill to BP to pay for it. Simple answer, that's what any other country in the world would do. What did we do? We said, no. We'll wait till BP figures out how to clean it up. And we literally have done that. We have said, you guys, send us a note when you get it cleaned up. And very little pressure on BP. In fact, we were like sort of really concerned that we not be too tough on BP after they had despoiled the Gulf. Even now, we've pressured them so hard that they run ads on TV talking about what a great job they're doing now, the better part of a decade after they despoiled the Gulf. Well, you know what? I don't want them to tell me what a great job they're doing. I want the job done. I wanted it done a long time ago. And I'll tell you, a corporation that has to, at the first step, assure that its shareholders are paid, that its profits are indeed embedded, is not going to rush as rapidly to clean up our waters and our coastlines as the government that represents us. It is as simple as that. So we took social democratic idea off the table. But let me give you the biggest place where we as a country took the social democratic response off the table. A bunch of billionaires. Has everybody seen The Big Short? If you haven't seen The Big Short, go see it, because it's absolutely fabulous. In fact, I mean, it really is brilliant. They take the complex ideas of our absolutely decaying banking system, and they let like fashion models and rock stars and chefs explain it, because they know that we wouldn't possibly pay attention. So they actually have like Anthony Bourdain, the celebrity chef, like chopping up fish and saying, yeah, this is how a mortgage works. You see, you get old fish and it's not very good. Nobody wants to eat it. You chop it up like this and then you put it in a stew and you tell them, you give it a French name and everybody thinks it's fresh and wonderful and they eat it. That's how we do your mortgages. We put the bad fish into your mortgage and then you think it's a good thing. Fabulous film. But you know what? It's kind of a funny film, but there's nothing funny about what they did. A bunch of bankers crashed the global economy and created a circumstance where unemployment in the United States was rising at a rate of 900,000 a month. Literally, people were losing jobs at an epic rate. Unemployment was going through the roof. We literally destabilized our economy to such a point that it has still, to this day, not righted itself. In fact, interestingly enough, despite actually some pretty credible work by President Obama, the fact of the matter is that the reason Donald Trump is doing well as a presidential candidate, the reason Bernie Sanders is doing well as a presidential candidate, the reason there's so much anger out there, even though the stock market is up, is because the average person knows full well that we have not repaired the economy from what happened in 2007 and 2008. And so, what would you do in that circumstance? When a bunch of bankers crash the global economy, I will tell you this. In a social democracy, you would not give them $1 trillion. But that's exactly what we did. We took $1 trillion. In fact, we actually took loan guarantees up to, you know, many, many trillions of dollars. And we said, you know what, bankers? You're all going to be bailed out. We're going to take care of all of you. And any loans that you put out, we're going to cover them as well. We locked up the global economy to bail out the people that wrecked the global economy. We slowed our recovery down. We slowed our recovery down to a snail's pace. And we still, to this day, in this country, have debates about how much we should cut food stamps. We have bailed out the bankers, but we're debating how much we should cut food stamps. That's not socialism. That's not social democracy. That's not common sense. And the point of my argument is this. I don't come to tell you that socialism is the answer. It's not my point to tell you that socialism is the answer. It is my point to tell you that every once in a while, a socialist might have a good idea. Every once in a while, there might be a proposal that is better than the corrupt proposal from the center. And so, when a libertarian comes along and says, you know what? I don't think this drug war is working. I think maybe we should decriminalize drugs, emphasize health care over crime and punishment. That's a good idea coming from the side that ought to come into the middle. When a libertarian says in the 1970s, you know what? It's no skin off my nose if a couple of lesbians want to get married. It's no skin off my nose if somebody who's gay wants to open up a business or do whatever. I don't want to discriminate against them. That's a good idea that came from one side and has come into the middle. Well, just as a libertarian can have a good idea, so can a socialist. And I'm telling you, single-payer, Medicare for all, health care, a social democratic idea, that can come from the side into the middle. It is a common sense solution. Having the government clean up an absolute disaster rather than waiting for the corporation to do that, that may be a social democratic idea, but you bring that into the middle, it is a good solution. And frankly, when a bunch of bankers crash the global economy, giving the people who have been harmed by that crash loan guarantees and protections, working up from the bottom, making sure that mortgages are shored up, rather than giving all this money to the banks at the top, that may be a social democratic response, but that is a good idea. That is an idea from the side that ought to come to the middle. And you know what else? Another good idea that ought to come from the side into the middle, that we don't need to spend more than the rest of the world combined on a military-industrial complex that takes all of our available revenues and keeps moving them over to the side rather than keeping enough in there to feed people, to house people, to care for folks, to give education, to give the basics of a humane and decent society. Country, yes, you may applaud that, Olivia. That is the right point. And that is an idea that social democrats have talked about forever. So my point is, socialist and social democratic ideas are healthy and functional and useful to a civil society. And yet, for a very long time, they've been pushed to the fringe. They have not been a part of our discourse for so long that now, when a democratic socialist is running for president, Bernie Sanders from Vermont, people are saying, oh my gosh, a democratic socialist could never, ever be elected in America. A democratic socialist, boy, if you nominate a democratic socialist, that's the end of all time. You're like, oh, so it's over, right? People will run screaming from the room because democratic socialism is a foreign concept. Socialism is a foreign concept. It's got nothing to do with America. It came from some other place. Well, you know, if Bernie Sanders wins the New Hampshire primary in 18 days, if Bernie Sanders wins here, what? 16, we'll take it down that ladder. He won't be the first socialist to win in New Hampshire. What? What are you talking about? Now, 80 years ago, up in Berlin, yeah, there's a woman, in the car goes, hold it, my memory's starting to kick in here. 80 years ago, up in Berlin, I hope I got his name right, Arthur Bergeron, who was a lawyer in Berlin, and who had a newspaper up there called the, I hope I pronounce this right, Koas Guardian newspaper, came out every week, preached socialism. He got elected mayor up there, and in fact, as mayor, created all sorts of programs for the unemployed, helped to stabilize the region, was an incredibly successful mayor for a number of years up there, a socialist elected in New Hampshire. Now, you know, that's crazy, but only New Hampshire. I know, it's a kooky state. It couldn't have happened anyplace else. No, actually, over the history of the United States, thousands of socialists have been elected to city councils, to school boards, to the mayoralties. Do you know who was the first socialist in our U.S. Congress? Not Bernie Sanders. No. It was Victor Berger, elected in Milwaukee, Wisconsin in 1910. He was joined a few years later by Meyer London from New York City. In fact, socialists elected on the Socialist Party ticket, not as Democrats, not as mild versions thereof, but actual scorching socialists. It's the interesting thing about it. Socialists have been mayors of big cities in the United States. Socialists have been sheriffs. Socialists have been school board members. Socialists have run things in this country. And you know what? The country did not come to an end. America survives. And in fact, the interesting thing is that these socialists and social democrats who have been mayors and city council members and school board members, members of Congress, members of the United States Senate, who've been presidential candidates and received millions of votes, who have influenced the history of this country. These socialists have been written out of our history because it's convenient not to remember them. It's convenient to say that they are foreign, they are the other, that somehow America cannot entertain these ideas. And just as it would be wrong to write our libertarian forebears out of our history, and they go back all the way to John Randolph of Roanoke at the founding of the country, just as it would be wrong to write our libertarian forebears out, it is wrong to write our socialist and social democratic forebears out, because if we do so, we become a country that cannot solve its own problems. We think that there are certain things that are off the table because it is not of us. And so I would only suggest to you, well, where did this socialism thing start? What foreign place did it begin? Oh, with Tom Paine. Tom Paine, the author of Common Sense.
He was English.
Ah, but he came to America. Can you imagine Tom Paine? This is an interesting thing about Tom Paine. Imagine this guy. He's a trade union organizer. He organized the tax collectors in England. He was an anti-royalist He was a guy who had some marital problems and all sorts of other troubles. He finally gets chased out of England. He gets on a ship. He gets totally sick on the ship. They have to pull him off the ship, drag him out, and they dump his sick, almost lifeless body in a rooming house in Philadelphia. And a month later, he's writing tracts about how we have to overthrow the king, and, or at least suggested the concept, and a year later, barely a year after they dumped this immigrant, this sick immigrant trade union organizer, in a rooming house in Philadelphia, he has written Common Sense and called us to revolution at Walpole. That's a pretty good organizer. And Tom Paine was, of course, the guy who said, we have it in our power to begin the world over again. These are these incredible concepts that he suggested to begin the world anew. Tom Paine, who Ronald Reagan happily quoted on a regular basis. Well, Tom Paine didn't stop writing in 1776. He kept writing. His last major work was Agrarian Justice, written in the late 1790s. Agrarian Justice proposed a social welfare state. And what you would do was give everybody, at the time that they came to adulthood, a guaranteed income, a guaranteed amount of money, because he said you could not have a democracy if some people came to adulthood and were very, very wealthy and some were very, very poor. How could that, how could you have a functional society with great wealth and great poverty? So he said, no, we have to take money and give it to those who are impoverished. In fact, give it to everybody on an even level so that everybody has an equal stake. Everybody has an equal chance. He also said that for old people, if you're too old to work, you can't be become, you know, thrown on the scrap heap of history. You can't become a burden to your family. No, if you're old, Tom Paine said, we should create a social welfare system for the elderly. Something like, I don't know, Social Security. In fact, if you go to the Social Security Administration site to this day, if you read their website, they say, where did the idea for Social Security come from? Tom Paine, Agrarian Justice. He also proposed, amazingly enough, a healthcare program. He said, if you're sick, you can't take care of yourself, right? You know, you can't expect your family to do it because people don't have enough to do that. So Tom Paine said, we should have a healthcare system that ensures that anybody who gets sick can have basic healthcare, single-payer healthcare. Tom Paine. And where would you get this money to do this wonderful thing? He said, very, very simple, tax the rich. Not a complicated concept. He said, people have great amounts of land. And you know, Paine didn't want to harm people. He didn't want to harm the rich. He said, if somebody's rich, and that's fine. He says, but if they've got 40,000 acres of land, they can't farm all that. So we are going to make sure that we have a fair distribution of the wealth. Somebody who gets wealthy, that's fine. But nobody lives in abject poverty. We create a floor in which we build a civil society and a democracy. Tom Paine. It wasn't some Russian. It wasn't some Hungarian. It wasn't a German. And you know what happened? Agrarian Justice, not a popular book in the United States, but a popular book around the world. Here's the incredible thing. Agrarian Justice was read by people all over the world. Don't forget your scarf, ma'am.
Thank you. I just have to go. I'm with it.
No, I know you are. Don't go. Don't worry. But so, Agrarian Justice, hugely successful book globally. And how many of you know who Fanny Wright is? Wave your hands high. Come, all you feminists, Fanny Wright. Fanny Wright. Uh-oh. We got some history work to do here. I promise you I'm not going to take you all night long here, but this is a simple one. So, Tom Paine's Agrarian Justice and all these other books, they end up on the bookshelf of a Scottish industrialist. And his daughter, Fanny, reads all these books. And in the 1820s, his daughter Fanny, as a lovely young Scottish woman, writes to the great revolutionaries of the world. Now, Tom Paine had passed on, but the Marquis de Lafayette was still alive. And so she wrote letters to France and in America and around the world. The only one who responded was the Marquis de Lafayette. If you've ever known anything about Lafayette, that's not a surprise. And Lafayette says, well, I'm going to America. Why don't you escort me? And Fanny Wright, strong woman, she said, I'll go to America, but don't get any ideas, mister. And Lafayette said, it's great. I just want to, you know, I'm glad to introduce you to people. So Fanny Wright came to America with Lafayette, having read all this Paine. And she went up and down the East Coast. Lafayette took her to Monticello. In the last years of Thomas Jefferson's life, Fanny Wright, steeped in Paineite theories, steeped in all these ideas, sat at Monticello as a young woman in her 20s with Thomas Jefferson. And she said, Mr. Jefferson, I love that all men are created equal thing in the Declaration of Independence. That was fabulous, but what about these slaves? She went up and down there asking these fundamental questions. And when she did not get satisfactory answers, she used her personal wealth to buy slaves out of slavery and to create a communal farming center in the 1820s in Tennessee. Fanny Wright, where whites and blacks lived together on a communal farm, because she said, this slavery system, this capitalism, divides us in ways we cannot allow to happen. And after she got run out of Tennessee, because you can imagine it didn't go over as easily as you would hope, she moved to New York City. And in the late 1820s, there was this young woman who campaigned on the street corners of New York City for what was then called the Working Men's Party, the first socialist party in the United States. They were not called Working Men's Party, they were called Fanny Wrightists. And in 1828, 1829, as they elected members of the New York City Council, the first avowed socialists or social democrats, even before the word had come into parlance, were elected in America. They served in the New York City Council. They served in the New York State Legislature. They inspired a movement called Vote Yourself a Farm. The Vote Yourself a Farm movement said, let us use our democracy to create a social democracy. And one of the young people that got inspired by the Vote Yourself a Farm movement was Horace Greeley. Now, Horace Greeley went on to become one of the greatest newspaper editors in American history. He edited the New York Herald Tribune, New York Tribune, and his newspaper went all over the country. And he had a radical idea, which is that we're going to fight slavery. But also, do you know that Horace Greeley had a socialism correspondent writing columns on his front page? The great Republican newspaper of America, preaching socialist gospel. Now, here's the interesting thing. In 1848, when the great revolutions of Europe started out, Horace Greeley sent Charles Dana, his editor, over to Europe, and he said, find me a good correspondent to write about things going on in Europe. Dana traveled around Europe with all these revolutions going on. He came back to America. He said, I found you. I didn't find you one. I found you two. Greeley was, that's fantastic. Who do you got for me? Charles Dana said, Marx and Lenin. No, Marx and Engels. Marx and Engels. So Marx and Engels became the European correspondents for the major Republican newspaper in the United States. You know who read that newspaper every week?
Abraham.
Guy who worked in the post office there in Illinois? Abraham Lincoln. The interesting thing is when I did the book, I actually tracked things that were in the paper, in Greeley's paper, and then things that Lincoln was doing from his diary. Greeley's paper would write about Marx would write about a revolutionary action in Hungary. Lincoln would have a solidarity meeting, just like Central American solidarity, with the Hungarian revolutionaries. There's no question that Lincoln read these things. It's an undebatable point. And we know this for another reason. When Abraham Lincoln was elected president, as head of the Republican Party, which was packed with these Germans who had fled in 1848 to come to the United States, when Abraham Lincoln was elected president, he appointed Charles Dana, Marx and Engels' editor, as his White House assistant. And when Lincoln gave his first, what is equivalent of a State of the Union address, his first major address to Congress, he said, he was talking about the Civil War. Nothing to be denied here. This was a horrible circumstance. And he went on at great length about the Civil War. And then he said, midway through the speech, he says, I would be remiss if I did not mention one other thing here. You read the speech, it's from December, late 1861. It says, I need to state clearly that labor is superior to capital. That we must have a society in which those who work for a living have much the better circumstance, right, are much more respected by our governance than those who just simply deal in money. Labor is superior to capital. Abraham Lincoln, 1861, when Abraham Lincoln ran for re-election in 1864, he met with the working men's clubs, radical groupings from across this country, and said, you know, look, this is our struggle is for a democracy that ends slavery, but also that also ends wage slavery, that ends the circumstance where people are so oppressed that their work is not fairly compensated. Does this make Lincoln a socialist? No. Does this make Lincoln any kind of communist? No, it doesn't. It makes Lincoln somebody who was informed by ideas, someone who had read about different notions and incorporated them into the discourse. I'm not here to preach socialism, brothers and sisters. That's not what I've come to do. I've come to tell you that we need to be as open as Lincoln was. We need to be open to different ideas and ideas that might actually solve our problems. Lincoln's most radical act, aside from the Emancipation Proclamation, which I wear on my tie, Lincoln's most radical act was the Homestead Act. The Homestead Act. What did they do? They did what Paine talked about. They took huge amounts of land and gave it to poor people, to immigrants and urban poor. The Homestead Act gave people land to live on and to build a life on. It was actually an incredible redistribution of wealth. And it happened not, you know, under Barack Obama, not under Bernie Sanders, Abraham Lincoln. This is an important thing to understand. This is a part of our history. And so too is Eugene Victor Debs. Eugene Victor Debs ran for president again and again and again and again and again. Did not hesitate. He got beat, but Eugene Victor Debs received 6% of the vote nationally. That's three times what Nader got in 2000. More than two times. And Eugene Victor Debs was a socialist, no question about that. He did not win the presidency, but during his campaigns for the presidency 100 years ago, socialists were elected as mayors, city council members, school board members, members of Congress, county board members, county sheriffs, county clerks, across this country. Socialists formed the opposition caucuses in legislatures in this country. It was Republicans, socialists, then the Democrats in places like Wisconsin. And when Debs passed the torch on to Norman Thomas, 1932, Norman Thomas ran for president of the United States, received almost 1 million votes. That was right around the time where you folks were electing your socialist mayor up in northern New Hampshire. Eugene Victor Debs passed it on to Norman Thomas, and Norman Thomas created a new vision of socialism that incorporated both the economic components, but also a real peace and justice component. Not that Debs wasn't good on these issues, but Thomas went out and literally marched in the 30s for civil rights, marched in the 30s for anti-war and anti-militarism causes. And here's the interesting thing. When he got that almost a million votes in 1932, what did Franklin Roosevelt do? In the spring of 1933, Franklin Roosevelt invited his friend, Norman Thomas, to the White House to scope out ideas for how they might respond to a Great Depression. And if you want to know the roots of the New Deal, look at Norman Thomas, because the roots of the New Deal were social democratic responses to America's challenges. Remember, it was socialists who put ideas like Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid on the table initially, and even more radical things like public education. And I close my remarks with this. One of Norman Thomas's best friends was a guy named A. Philip Randolph. A. Philip Randolph was the head of the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters. He's an African American. Randolph was a dandy. He dressed fabulously. He was one of the most dynamic figures in New York City. They said he was the most dangerous man in America. Now, sleeping car porters, I don't know if you know what a sleeping car porter was. Some of the older folks more may. A sleeping car porter was an African American gentleman who worked on a sleeping car, and his job on the train was to tuck in the rich white guys. Right? That was what you did. And you cared for the wealthy people that were riding in these elite sleeping cars across America. They were not unionized. They were not even allowed to use their first name. They were all given the name of Mr. Pullman's first name, because if they had their own first name, it would be complicated for the rich people to remember, right? So they were dehumanized in this circumstance. A group of these sleeping car porters went to A. Philip Randolph, and they said, look, we can't If one of us becomes leader of our union, we can't run things. So we need you to be our leader. A. Philip Randolph marched in, became the leader of the Brotherhood of Sleepy Car Porters, but he said, I won't do it if this is just about organizing a union. I want to change the economics, and I want to change the race relations of this country. And A. Philip Randolph said to those sleeping car porters, after you've tucked those rich guys in at night, I want you to take these newspapers. I want you to take socialist newspapers, because A. Philip Randolph was a socialist. I want you to take radical newspapers, and I want you to wrap them up. I want you to take the New York Times, if one of these rich guys is reading it. I want you to take whatever information you can get. I want you to put a rubber band around it. And as you go through the backyards of those towns across America, as you go through the rural South across this country, as you go through back behind the big houses, back by the shotgun shacks, late at night before you go to sleep, I want you to throw those newspapers onto the steps of those shacks. I want you to make sure that all those African-American folks across this country get the word. Get the word that there's an alternative to segregation and Jim Crow and economic dislocation, economic dysfunction. And A. Philip Randolph kept doing that with such success. He made Franklin Roosevelt integrate the defense industries before World War II. He made Harry Truman integrate the army in 1948. He made Eisenhower take seriously what was happening down in Birmingham and Montgomery in the 1950s. Do you know what the interesting thing is? Do you know who picked up Rosa Parks after she was arrested? One of A. Philip Randolph's organizers down there in Montgomery. In fact, A. Philip Randolph had a web of social democratic activism and civil rights activism intermingling him. It was A. Philip Randolph who called the 1963 March on Washington. A. Philip Randolph, the chairman of the march, who invited Dr. King to come to that march. A. Philip Randolph. A. Philip Randolph, who when that march was finished, the next morning, on the front page of the New York Times, lost to history, appeared at the Socialist Party's celebration of the March on Washington with Dr. King and others who had been at the march, Walter Reuther, a great social democrat from the UAW, and there on the front page of the New York Times, they have all these quotes from Randolph and others talking about where they're going to take the civil rights movement, comfortably reported that they were at the Socialist Party's meeting. Wasn't a big deal. This is the important thing to understand. 50, 60 years ago in this country, we were comfortable with the word socialism. We weren't all socialists. We didn't all embrace it. But we were comfortable enough that it didn't end anything. It didn't stop anything. We took social democratic ideas. We took radical ideas, if they were good ideas, and we made them a part of who we were. We have diminished ourselves. We have lost something in our discourse. And brothers and sisters, I don't come to you to tell you what to believe. But I do come to you to say that if we're ever going to repair this country, if we're ever going to make this country what it ought to be, we shouldn't go into our debates with a narrow, tiny little set of ideas dictated to us by the wealthiest people in the world. We ought to come to that table with the widest range of brilliant ideas from all over the world. They can be libertarian ideas. They can be socialist ideas. They can be ideas from all over the place, but they cannot be ideas dictated by someone who wants to enrich themselves at the expense of everyone else. They must be ideas that are rooted in a concept that we can actually do something better. I don't ask that we become some sort of radical republic. I simply ask that we become the Republic of Abraham Lincoln, the country where Abraham Lincoln knew that we needed to fight a war against slavery. Took him a while to come to that, but also knew that as we address slavery, we must also address economic injustice. And he did a Homestead Act. I want us to be the country, I want us to be the country of John Kennedy. When John Kennedy read the New Yorker magazine article based on Michael Harrington's book, The Other America, Michael Harrington, a great socialist, John Kennedy said, boy, I had no idea things were that bad. I think we maybe ought to do something about this. And do you know that in the Kennedy-Johnson years, they invited Michael Harrington and A. Philip Randolph to the White House to advise them on how to do a war on poverty? They didn't push the socialists away. They weren't afraid if a socialist came into the White House. They invited them in.
They didn't solve all the problems, but at least they took the ideas in. If Lyndon Johnson could take social democratic ideas in, then brothers and sisters, our presidents and our members of Congress can today. So I end on that note, but with one final favorite story. When Kennedy read that New Yorker article, he was very fascinated by the issues that were raised. And one of his advisors said, well, you know, that's based on Michael Harrington's book. And so he said, well, I'd like to give me a copy of that book. And so that book was, you know, brought around. Michael Harrington's The Other America. In 2010, a group of conservatives came for an American Conservative Political Action Conference, and they were touring the White House. And this guy's going through the library at the White House, and he sees a couple of books on socialism in the shelf. And he writes a blog saying, this is what the Obamas have done to us. They brought socialist books into the White House. Well, he's quickly corrected by librarians, who said, no, Jackie Kennedy, back in the early 1960s, asked for the greatest books written in America. She wanted to put a small library together in the White House, and these were recommended by a group of academics, conservatives and liberals, books that should be read, and some of the books that they recommended were histories of socialism in America, which was not some crazy concept, but it was in fact a part of our history. But the fascinating thing was the conservative that got all upset about that and wrote his blog about that took a picture of it. And I looked at that picture, and there were a couple of academic histories of socialism in America. But next to them was Michael Harrington's The Other America. Now, the conservative blogger that wrote about that didn't know who Harrington was, didn't note that book at all. But here's the wonderful thought I have. That was probably the book that was brought to John Kennedy when John Kennedy said, I want to do something about poverty in America. And that was the most socialist book on that shelf. Thank you for having me.
What time is it, folks? What time you got?
I don't have a clock.
5:10.
5:10. Good. We've done better than I would have expected. We'll take a couple questions and we'll get you out. I'm gonna. But you can also, I'll get you home in time to see the end of the Patriots. Do you know what Zephyr Teachout, by the way, who's running for, what? Zephyr Teachout, great reformer, thinking of running for Congress, said, you know what? She says, I don't want you to be pundits, I want you to be citizens. You guys are good citizens. Let me introduce the greatest citizen in the room. I'm sorry. Like, the reason I'm here, and you know, I'm coming up to a couple events in New Hampshire, is because I was invited by my absolute hero. And my hero is a New Hampshire state legislator. Now that's a joke because there's 400 of them, so you know it's hardly something that stands out. But the reason that this person is my hero is because she had a whole career, she had a whole life. She retired to New Hampshire. She got excited by Howard Dean's campaign for president. And then after Howard Dean got pushed aside in 2004, there's some interview where he said, you know, if you vote, you're like maybe a quarter of a citizen. And if you give a campaign contribution, you're maybe half of a citizen. And if you volunteer a little bit, you're probably three quarters of a citizen. Boy, if you run for office, you're a full-scale, full-on citizen. Well, this woman who's retired, living her, you know, kind of comfortable life up here in New Hampshire, she took that seriously. And she said, I got to run for office. So it was the fall of 2004. She looked at the ballot. It was already set. There was a Republican state legislator in her district. And so this woman decides to run as a write-in candidate for the state legislature. And she knocks on the doors, and she beats the Republican incumbent. And she has served in the legislature ever since as the great champion of economic and social justice, and the woman who took on the American Legislative Exchange Council before most of us even knew what it was, a woman who is absolutely my pick, and I've done it in The Nation magazine, my pick as the outstanding legislator in the United States of America. Ladies and gentlemen, Marsha Mooney. Woo-hoo!
Question.
I was
wondering if you could mention Emma Lazarus, Helen Keller.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yes. Well, Marcia asks a question about who was a socialist in America? Because we know Sarah Palin is not, right? Sarah Palin's not, because she's made that very, very clear. Although, if you look at Alaska's oil payment stuff, that's a pretty good guaranteed income sort of approach. But the interesting thing is, there have been so many people who have identified in American history as socialists. And one of the most passionate socialists in American history was Helen Keller. And Helen Keller was such a militant socialist, she would campaign on the street corners of New York. Now, those of you who are older know the story of Helen Keller. Not a person who, you know, you think of as some sort of great street corner campaigner, but in fact, she was an absolutely passionate, committed socialist. And she would say, I cannot see or hear. I've got all these infirmities, but even I can figure out that economic injustice is wrong. And so all these people with all these advantages ought to be able to figure it out. And so she was this wonderful campaigner. She was so militant that her book publishers would urge her to go on European tours during presidential election campaigns because they thought she would scare people with her radicalism. But Helen Keller was a wonderful character in this regard. So was Albert Einstein. Albert Einstein wrote a pamphlet on his socialism and his arguments for socialism. He says, look, I don't know why people call me the smartest guy in the world, but, you know, if you want to know, I mean, I don't just think about physics. I think about how you create a decent economy, and the way you create a decent economy is to make sure you don't spend all your money on armaments and nuclear bombs and things like that. You spend your money on human beings. You bring that money home, and you do good things with it, and you do it around the world through foreign aid, and he argued for socialism. In fact, the fact of the matter is that many of the people that we regard most highly in our history were socialists or social democrats, or most importantly, to my mind, people who were informed by these ideas, people who borrowed from these ideas, people who didn't become socialists, maybe even people who didn't become, you know, any kind of radical, but they said, well, that I like that idea, I'm going to use that because I put nothing off the table. But my favorite of these was Emma Lazarus. Yeah. The woman who wrote the wonderful poem, The New Colossus, which is on the Statue of Liberty. In the introduction to my book, I'm trying to explain this history, I'm trying to explain how much we've lost. And so I wrote about Emma Lazarus. Emma Lazarus is a wealthy Jewish woman who lived in New York City. She was an Ashkenazi Jew, and of the upper class. In the late 1800s, early 1900s, a lot of poor Jews were coming to the United States, and a lot of poor immigrants from many, many different cultures were coming to the United States. They were not being treated well. They were being treated horribly. And so Emma Lazarus went out and organized to care for poor immigrants. And she wrote this poem, The New Colossus, which they put on the Statue of Liberty. And it was a very radical concept, right? It says, instead of pushing people away, boy, I'm still trying to figure out how Donald Trump deals with that poem, right? Give me your poor, right? Give me your tired, give me those who everybody else has pushed away. And I've read that poem recently. I've read Emma Lazarus's poem recently. And I think about the horrific condition of Syrian refugees who are on these boats. And she's writing about tempest tossed. She's writing about people on these ships in these horrible circumstances, trying to come to a place of safety. Hello, Elizabeth. And this wonderful, wonderful poem. Well, Emma Lazarus was a radical. She backed Henry George's radical campaigns for mayor of New York City. And Emma Lazarus was so inspiring to poor immigrants that they formed something called the Emma Lazarus Society. It was mostly Jewish women. And as time went on, they came to call themselves the Emmas. There was Emma Lazarus societies in cities across the United States. And they were the Emmas. When they were young, they were like these teenagers or young women in their early 20s, and they would gather together and give solidarity and support to other immigrants, but also education. They became activists. They got involved in campaigns against anti-Semitism. The Emmas were very active
long before others in this country and saying something horrible is happening in Europe and America must care about what's happening to the Jews of Europe. They also were early on in saying that we as Jews must worry about the condition of African Americans and the condition of others who have been neglected and denied by this society. They did wonderful work. They were some of the really pioneering feminists in this country. But the Emma's got, as time went on, the Emma Lazarus societies around the country got a little bit smaller, a little bit quieter, these radical old ladies, right? And, you know, by the 1960s, not everybody was talking to the Emmas. Not that nobody's neglected them, but they weren't at the center of everything that was going on. But when A. Philip Randolph organized the March on Washington, and by the way, the Emmas were all called socialists. In fact, some of their leaders who were immigrants were actually, you know, told they had to leave the country because of their radical ideas. But when A. Philip Randolph, who was also a socialist, was organizing the March on Washington, John Kennedy said, boy, I don't know, having tens of thousands of African Americans march in the city, in these, you know, we've just had these bombings and these horrible incidents. Things are very, very unstable in this country. And there was concern about the March on Washington. And A. Philip Randolph thought to himself, you know what, I want to make sure that everybody sees this isn't just about African Americans. This is about all people. Not just when you end segregation and Jim Crow, you aren't just taking care of African Americans in the South. You are reaching out and taking care of all human beings. You're making this a better country. And he says, oh, you know, I probably want to make sure that we've got a crowd of folks who you know can communicate the diversity of this movement. And so the organizers of the March on Washington contacted the Emma Lazarus societies. And they said, you should come, we need you in Washington. And so the last great action of the Emma Lazarus Societies founded at the turn of the century, honoring Emma Lazarus's great poem and her radical commitment, one of the last great missions of the Emma Lazarus Societies, all these old Jewish women, was to get on buses and to go to New York, or go to Washington, D.C. And if you look at pictures from the March on Washington, there in front, you know, you have all these people, this incredible, remarkable diversity of people, but there down in front, on their picnic blankets, in their dresses, are the Emmas. 70 years on from Emma Lazarus, radicals, with a radical idea, throwing themselves into a new civil rights movement. That's solidarity. And that's social democracy. Again, I don't tell you what to believe. But what I will tell you is the people who have believed in these ideals have maintained them over incredible periods of time and done incredibly beautiful things. And when we deny our history, when we deny that element of our history, we don't write the whole story of the United States. We write a narrow, lifeless story of this country. The full story of this country includes the Emma Lazarus Society. It includes the Emmas, who went there with A. Philip Randolph to say it's time to end segregation, it's time to end Jim Crow, it's trying to make this country real for all Americans. When I wrote the book, I wrote about the Emmas as the introduction. And I also wrote about my daughter, who's upstairs there. That's Whitman up top with Elizabeth. And I wrote that my daughter's grandmother was a Wisconsin progressive, and the Wisconsin progressives aligned with the socialists in the 1930s. In fact, the socialists backed Robert M. La Follette for president in 1924, got better part of 5 million votes. And that's Whitman's grandma, and Whitman's best buddy, or one of her best buddies, is a girl named Sylvie, and her grandmother was an Italian immigrant who had been a partisan fighting against the fascists in Europe. And it happened that there were these two little girls who knew very little about their grandmothers, right, and knew nothing about the Emmas. But I want to make sure they grow up in a country where they know everything about the Emmas and everything about their grandmothers and everything about the history, the whole history of this country. I don't mind telling the story of generals. I don't mind telling the story of presidents. But I'm absolutely committed to the view that everything that's great about this country started a lot below the level of general and a lot below the level of president. That everything that's great about this country came from people like those Emmas who got on those buses at 70, 80, 90 years old to go down and finally challenge the sin of segregation, the sin of Jim Crow and to say that they did not immigrate to this country to be a part of a system that oppressed someone else. It's a wonderful history. This is a wonderful country. This is as cool a country as you're going to find. It's just that we don't tell the whole story of this country. And when we don't tell the whole story of this country, it becomes possible to believe that we are only the things that offend our sensibilities and that trouble us. We're better than that. Yes.
Thank you. In terms of telling the whole story, in terms of the current moment, let's say with Bernie, I wonder how. I don't know if you have Bernie's ear at all.
Not really. I've known him over the years.
I mean, I think he's doing amazingly well. I think in terms of reaching the widest national audience, I think he could do better explaining what he means by revolution, for example, which he means participation, as you were describing, but also in terms of the history of socialist ideas in this country. You mentioned public education as a radical idea, but there are a lot of things that, like that, that people think are really good, even though they're socialistic. Yeah. Public parks, public beaches, police and fire.
Streets.
public streets, highways, Medicare. But also, in terms of your work on the media, the stuff you've written with Bob McChesney about the rise of the establishment press, what do you think the prognosis is for the media actually being able to give those ideas fair voice? And the last time I saw Arnie was on a TV show where I was being mauled by the guys from the Boston Herald and the Boston Globe, remember that? which I thought I did terribly, and Arnie closed me up after and said, "You were great, everybody in the room was cheering you."
That's what we love about Arnie.
Yeah. But it was the mainstream media, the corporate media, they're very, in terms of reporting under the influence.
Excellent. What a terrific question. And so let's do two quick things here. First off, I wrote the new edition of the S Word, which came out a month or so ago, has a new introduction. And it begins with Bernie Sanders on This Week with George Stephanopoulos. And George Stephanopoulos says to him, he's asking him some questions. This is back in like May or maybe early June. Asking him some questions, and Bernie Sanders is doing fine. And then George Stephanopoulos gets to the big one. He says, "Yeah, but let's talk about the elephant in the room. You're a socialist." And the incredible thing was that you realize this is the first time that I know of in American history that a serious contender for the presidency of the United States was on television as a socialist. Right? You would be asked about your socialism. That Eugene Victor Debs wasn't on TV, neither was Norman Thomas, except in his later years when William F. Buckley used to have him on all the time on Firing Line, but that was after he had run for president. That doesn't happen very often, right? Now, what was incredible was not the question or even the reality of that moment. What was incredible was Bernie Sanders' response. Because instead of saying what every Democrat has said, for as long as I can remember, which is, right? And, run screaming from the room because the S word had been mentioned. Bernie Sanders said, "Yeah, that's what I am."
Did the same thing on Meet the Press. And he said, "How come you don't ask all the other candidates?"
Why, they're capitalists. Exactly. And the amazing thing about Bernie Sanders, you can love Bernie Sanders or hate Bernie Sanders. You can support him or oppose him. You take it where you want to go with that. But let me tell you something. To have a guy who goes on national television and says, "Yeah, I'm a socialist, and that's a good thing," and then says, "And if people knew about democratic socialism, they would be very sympathetic to it." And he starts talking about Denmark. He starts talking about other places. And the incredible thing about it is, no matter what happens with his presidential candidacy, he has actually proven his point. That was at the start of his candidacy, right? We are now deep into this thing. We will see where all of this goes. But the fact of the matter is, he's proven his point because he went out there. There's nobody who doesn't know Bernie Sanders is a democratic socialist. It's not some secret. Time magazine had a picture of him on the cover, and it said, "At Bernie Sanders said, socialize this." And, you know, I mean, it's Bernie Sanders, socialist. And then by the way, he's a senator and stuff like that. You know, so it's clearly been communicated. And you know what the weird thing is? He's doing pretty well.
Yeah.
And so what we're having is a moment where our discourse opens up. Now, our media desperately does not like that. Because it's not about personalities. It's not about, you know, who's a nice person or who looked at me the wrong way. Do you remember in the debate, this most recent Democratic debate, Hillary Clinton said something Bernie Sanders didn't approve of or didn't agree with, right? Bernie Sanders didn't go screaming or yelling, didn't attack her. But he did go like that. I think it was about single payer or something like that. And he looked, and all of our media is like, did you see what Bernie Sanders did with his eye? You know? And I mean, it's sort of like they're so absolutely desperate to talk about anything but ideas. And that is the crisis of American media. It is not, you know, when I talk about the narrowness of our discourse isn't narrow because the people ask for it. Our discourse is not narrow because it's natural for Americans. We are this freewheeling, very bold country where people actually, you know, at their best speak their mind and have done incredible things. And yet we get this incredibly empty, vapid, stupid discourse where it's like, did you see how she looked at him? Did you see what he said about, and I'm sorry. You know, I don't blame the American people for the imperfections of this country. Because when you've been marinated in the media that we have, it's amazing we're as good as we are. We have a horrible media system in this country, and we have a horrible politics in this country. And so what I see happening is a little opening of it. I don't know how far it's going to get. And I also will criticize Bernie Sanders. Because I don't know that he's quite figured out how to talk about all this. It's hard because as you're trying to do it, we shall see what works and what does not. I wish that Bernie Sanders had talked a good deal more about the military-industrial complex. I think that I'd like to see that more as a part of his discourse. I like what he said about, you know, wars of whim, and I like what he said about, you know, the unintended consequences of, you know, invasions and occupations. I think that's good, but I'd like to hear a lot more. I also think that I respect when Bernie Sanders talks about Denmark and Norway and Sweden. I think that's fine, and those are examples, but I would really like to hear some talk about Milwaukee.
Yeah.
And I'd like to hear some talk about public education and program Social Security and Medicare and Medicaid and these, you know, and Norman Thomas, to be quite honest. You know, when you talk about Franklin Roosevelt, as Sanders has, I think that's great, but I'd like to also hear saying, you know, where did Roosevelt get some of those ideas? And I do think, I'm cautious in that criticism for a reason. I think that when you get on this roller coaster ride, as Arnie and others can tell you, it's very, you know, it's real easy to stand on the sidelines and say, you know, you should be riding differently. You should be doing a different thing. I understand how hard it is. But I do think people should take that in. Because wherever this moment we're in ends up, right, whatever happens politically out of it, nobody should think that we've gotten all the way to a real open and valid discourse. We haven't. We have not. We have begun to open things up. That's really healthy. But I don't think we're anywhere near it, and I don't think our media is going to respond well to it. I will tell you why things are as open as they are right now. It is not because of ABC, NBC, CBS. And I say that somebody's done meet the press, and I actually like the, I don't mind doing, you know, I'm not some, you know, hating on everybody, but I'll tell you why things have opened up. It's because of social media. It's because of Twitter and Facebook and all these other vehicles. And it's because of groups like Governing Under the Influence, you know, the AFSC project, because they've actually gone out and forced questions in, not because it's come from our existing media system. So we should be fully conscious that this campaign will end with whatever result it ends with, and we will still have the same media system that we've got, and more importantly, we'll still have the same campaign finance system that we've got. And it's an important thing. I have friends who say, well, let's amend the Constitution. I favor amending the Constitution to get money out of politics, strongly. But I want to remind you, if we amend the Constitution to overturn Citizens United, we ricochet all the way back to 2009, which wasn't all that great. Arnie, and then I'm coming to you. Over. Yeah. Say it, Arnie, say it louder so we can all hear.
Des Moines Register poll, 43% of Iowa Democrats call themselves socialists, 38% call themselves capitalists. Wow. Can I repeat that? Now, I don't know if that question was ever asked in any other presidential primary, so I'm not sure there's a benchmark upon which we can sort of compare these two, but the fact that more Iowa Democrats describe themselves as socialists than capitalists tells you the conversation has changed and the chill is coming off the term.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. And you know where we began to see the chill come off the term? It's very interesting. Where we began to see the chill come off the term was long before all this happened. There were polls in 2010, 2011, after the collapse of the global economy, after the stock market collapse, after the most scorching recession since the Great Depression, there are polls that showed that among people under 30, they had more favorable views of socialism, in some cases, than capitalism. Now, I wonder why that would be. You know, and I'm not beginning to suggest that they all knew what socialism was. I doubt they did. But I know that they thought capitalism wasn't working very well. And this is why I begin these talks always by honoring Sarah Palin. Because when Sarah Palin takes her great moral authority and condemns social democracy and social democratic ideas, I think there are tens of millions of Americans who say, okay, tell me more about that. Yeah. Do you have a question, my dear?
I do. Like most immigrants from Central Europe,
yeah,
I came here years ago totally unafraid of the notion of socialism.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering what we can do with our public school system to educate our children not to be afraid of concepts such as socialism, but to weigh them on the basis of historical facts.
Where did you come from in Europe?
Germany.
From Germany. When did you come?
19. I was first here in 1950.
So
then I was 20 years old.
You were, and only a few years older now. And, what a wonderful question. What a great way to close off our discourse tonight, because it's been great to be with you, and I love you giving up your football for this. And also mostly to honor our dear friend Marcia, who brought us together and who has not, I think it's fair to say, you've had a couple of health challenges recently. It hasn't been perfect. And she is doing great and out here with us, and we are so thrilled that our good friend has put this all together. But what a wonderful way to close off this discourse with this great question. Because you know what the answer is? And I did this on Arnie's show recently. I said, you know where we begin? Let's go find our libertarian buddies. Let's go find our people. Let's find the people who are left out of this discourse. Let's find the people whose ideas are pushed to the sidelines. And let's begin by saying, we don't have to say, oh, I want to teach socialism in the schools. I want to teach, you know, this. No, what we ought to teach is a really honest spectrum of ideas. Let people hear a range of ideas. And let them hear a range of ideas about politics and about economics. Let us not, you know, in most of the world, they don't teach political science. They teach politics and economics together, right? Because why do you seek power, right? It is to have influence on the economy. Once we begin to link these things, once we begin to understand that in a democracy or in some sort of democratic republic, that elections ought to have consequences not merely for the media to tell us which personality won, but also have an influence on our economy, right? Once you teach people the wholeness of these ideas, I think a lot of your problems get solved, right? Because this is the interesting thing. When young people are given an opportunity to study a lot of different ideas, they don't all end up in one place. They go to different places. But what they do is follow their idealism and their hopes for the country. And I always go back at the founding of the American experiment in places like this. At the founding of the American experiment, the people who were in the forefront were mostly white guys. And that's pretty much still true. White guys tend to run an awful lot of stuff. Now, behind them were all the women and all the people of color and all the indentured servants, all the working class people who actually always carry the burden. That's why we had a chaise rebellion after the revolution, because the rich guys who didn't fight the revolution were trying to make the poor people pay the debts of the revolution. Be any less a part of things. And in fact, I love the whole of our demographic. I like everybody in this mix. But when we teach a range of ideas and let people then attach their youthful idealism to it, all sorts of things become possible. When we teach a narrow set of ideas, and when we teach people that the possibilities are limited, that the range of debate is from the center right to the center left, the range of debate is from the boring to the more boring, the range of the debate is from the corrupt to the more corrupt, the range of the debate is from we can't do that to we really can't do that, right? Then you drive generations away from our politics. The reason so many people who are in their 60s, 50s, 60s, and 70s now remain highly engaged with politics is because they went through the 60s. They went through the early 70s, and they're like, oh yeah, I saw what you can do, and it's really cool, right? You know, you can do a civil rights movement. You can do a women's rights movement. You can do an LGBTQ movement. You can take on a illegal and immoral war, and you can force it to end, and then you can force the President of the United States to resign because he was a crook. That's pretty amazing, right? That can keep you going through a lifetime. But the bottom line is, it's through a lot of disappointments, Arnie. But the bottom line is, the bottom line is that when you don't give people a chance to see all those possibilities, when you don't give people a chance to engage in all that, then what will they do? They will look for the safest route out. They'll look for a way to, you know, how can I make money? How can I, you know, because that's the only way to be in it. Well, that's not the answer. That's never been the answer. And it won't be the answer for America if we're going to be what we need to be. So we do need to teach a broader range. And the fact of the matter is, I'm not sure it's going to come easily, because education itself has become this political football. And so I think it becomes incumbent upon all of us. Do you know how the socialists of 100 years ago taught socialism? Not in the public schools. They taught it by coming out on a Sunday night when there was not a football game on TV, because there wasn't TV, but when there was something else going on. And they went to church halls and union halls and community centers, and they talked to each other. And I will suggest to you that at the end of the day, as teched up as we are, as modern as we are, that the bottom line for all of us is to start talking to each other and talking about our history and who we are. Because our history and who we are is so much better than what we are taught in school, or than what our politicians try to make us believe we are. And so I will send you out not with my charge, but with the charge of our dear friends from Governing Under the Influence. You've got a couple weeks in this state of New Hampshire to go out and challenge candidates for President of the United States on issues of war and peace, criminal justice, economic fairness. You can go ask them questions. When they get done in New Hampshire, they will never talk to another human being. So this is it. This is it, my friends. Once they get on that plane on February 10th or 11th, it's over for the, you know. So the whole of the United States is putting its charge on you, folks. Go out and ask them the most difficult and embarrassing questions and demand that they answer. Do it with your usual New Hampshire politeness.
Go see the ones you don't like.
Go see the ones you don't like, as Arnie says. But also, go see the ones you like. Because you know, at the end of the day, A. Philip Randolph was right. A. Philip Randolph said, I always reserve a lot of passion for my meetings with those I disagree with. but I reserve a little more passion for my meetings with those I agree with, because I gotta make those I agree with a whole lot better than they are. Solidarity, my friends, thank you.